Okay, hey there. Today we'll be doing a summary of new criticism. So new criticism is all about the text. There's no need to read hundreds of pages of history or dig up evidence of Jane Austen's love life. In fact, there's no need for anything but the text. You don't need to know where the author lived or whether the author was rich or poor, man or woman. So it's basically just the text that matters over here. If the text is good, if the book is well written, that's all that really matters. So the time period in which this idea started was during the 1920s to the 1970s, and it still exists today. So it started as a reaction against traditional criticism, because traditional criticism was, you had to know the author's background. It was very, they didn't want all that. They just wanted to focus on the text and take it really separately. So the method used here is close reading or intensive reading of the text. So we just have the text. We don't care about anything to do with the author. We just care about this text right here. So the major arguments or positions for new criticism is: one, a work of literature is autonomous. It is self-contained and self-referential. So the book that you're studying, everything that you need to know, it's in the book. You don't need to go and Google the author's name. In fact, the author is not really relevant at all. So another thing is focus on elements of the text. For example, character, setting, imagery, conflict, plot, rhythm, and rhyme. So all these elements are what you are looking for, and this is how you're going to criticize this work of art. So the third thing is consider that texts contain ambiguity, paradox, ironies, oppositions, which lead to various interpretations. So we don't just look at the author, his background and everything, and be like, okay, because, and his intention, and consider his or her intention, and consider that to be what the text means. We look at the text separately, and we look at everything that's in the text, for example, paradox or irony, oppositions, and we just study it separately. And from this, we could get various other interpretations. An example of this, I actually can think of Bohemian Rhapsody, the actual song. If you take the author's background, that is Freddie Mercury's background, if you consider his background and analyze the song lyrics, you'll get one interpretation, that is, he's a gay man and, he's he's ended someone's life by maybe giving him HIV or something like that. And if you read that poem, you can separately, I'm sorry, the lyrics separately, without considering the background and everything, you get an entirely different meaning. Although the words are the same, when you just analyze it from a different angle, you sort of change your filter of looking at it. Okay, next is historical background and assumptions. So new criticism arose in opposition to biographical or vaguely impressionist approaches. So it's like a response to people who are looking at the biography or like impressionist approaches. It sought to establish literary studies as an objective discipline. Objective because here we are just studying things within the text. We are not looking at other things at all. We are not looking at the author's background and all those superficial things. Those are extra. We are just looking at the text and we are just trying to see if it makes sense. Okay, then texts possess meaning in and of themselves. Therefore, an analysis should emphasize intrinsic features rather than extrinsic ones. So when we are analyzing the text, we have to look at intrinsic features. And what are these intrinsic features? They are the words that are in the text. They are the structural organization or internal pattern and interrelationship in the text. So rhyme, meter, all those things, that's what's important. Now, what's not important is the context in which it was written, the era of composition, the author, absolutely not important. The reader's emotional response. So what you feel when you read it is also extrinsic. It's not important at all. Major figures for new criticism are I.A. Richards. I.A. Richards. Okay. And he wrote Practical Criticism in 1929. It's sort of like an experimental, it's a book which, Practical Criticism basically contains the results of the experiments which he conducted on students. So he asked students to analyze text without any background. And what he found was that if the text was good, he found that you don't really need to know all the other things. The text alone sort of works as a standalone if it's good. Then P.S. Eliot also, in Tradition and Individual Talent, he looks at the value of work in its, and it's the relationship between, tradition and the individual talent, how the past affects the future and the present affects the past, sort of how that dynamic relationship is there, and why we need to have information of the past and all, but that should not be the only thing that is that we look at. So then there's F.R. Lewis, who I forgot. Then Kenneth Brooks, who wrote Understanding Poetry in 1939. Among others, these are the key figures in New Criticism. So the key terms in New Criticism are intentional fallacy, that is equating the meaning of a poem with the author's intention. Okay, so that's a fallacy is a mistake. So intentional fallacy. When we look at the intent of the poet and we equate that intent with the meaning. So I write a poem about a raven and I'm just talking, and you know, you really don't know what the hell I'm talking about unless you ask me. But if I say it's about depression, you know, and you don't really read depression off the poem, then there's definitely a difference in the text and what my intention was while writing it. Then there's affective fallacy, confusing the meaning of a text with how it makes the reader feel. So a reader's emotional response to a text generally does not produce a reliable interpretation, because how each one of us reacts to a text is different, right? Just because I read a poem and feel great joy reading it does not necessarily mean that you read it and feel a great sense of joy. So because how we react to things is also, it's also influenced by how we ourselves are shaped. And that's really very shaky. So affective fallacy. Then hearsay of paraphrase. Assuming that an interpretation of a literary work could consist of a detailed summary or paraphrase. Then close reading. A close and detailed analysis of the text itself to arrive at an interpretation without referring to historical, authorial, or cultural concerns. Then we have strength. So the strengths of New Criticism, which is also known as practical criticism because it's basically very practical. Then first of all, it deserves great credit for making us become more careful and serious readers, because in New Criticism, we focus on the text, we look at the text itself. So in a sense, we are more into the text. We're also not distracted by other things like the author's intent. We don't care about that. We just care about the text that we're reading. We're not interested in his background, which school he went to, he or she went to. We're not interested in their love life. We're not interested in how tragic or absolutely amazing or whatever their life was. We're just interested in that text. Then we have a deeper appreciation of the multiple uses of language that a text uses. So because we are focusing on the text itself, we are going to notice more of the structural elements in it. We're going to notice the figures of speeches. We're going to notice the rhyming pattern. We're going to notice the sentence structures, the way the, what's the word? I forgot the word. Punctuation. We're going to notice stuff like that. Anyway, so then we understand and we appreciate it better because we are essentially breaking down the, we can deconstruct the text better on its own. Isn't that lovely? Anyway, critiques or drawbacks of New Criticism is a reduction of literature to one or a few rhetorical devices like irony, paradox, tension, or texture. One drawback of this that I can see is that if we look at a text sole, there might be things that we do miss out because if we just look, we just break apart. Sometimes things are better looked on as a whole. So in that sense, we would not be able to get the best with the lens of New Criticism. So yeah. So it's sort of like really specific. You're reducing this lens that you're looking through a work of art. So some things can be missed out because of that. And then this alone altogether do not make a poem. Yeah, so just because you have irony, you have paradox, you have tension or texture does not mean that it's a poem, right? There's something else, something more sublime to make it a poem. Then also affective fallacy. This is a drawback. No work of literature or art can be divorced from the reader and therefore from the reader's response. How a work of art makes you feel is also really important. Although New Criticism denies you that, it is important how your response to it is. Maybe it's not the same as everyone else's response, but a response from someone who's viewing a work of art is essentially the highlight of that work of art. So.